not so much that you believe, but it's that God wants to see you do something about it. God wants to see you move. And what do I mean by that? I can ask all the time and I can believe, but I'm going to start demonstrating my faith and I'm going to start using my faith. But see, when God sees you demonstrate and using your faith, he has to move. You know, you look at the guy that was paralyzed. He knew that Jesus was in a nearby town. And what did he do? He told his four friends, take me. I got to go see him. I got to go see him. Because I know if I go see him, I know that my faith, I'm going to get healed. But here's the thing about it. When he went over there, he couldn't get in. For some of us, we're so close to knocking on that door, getting in, that we stop. And we stop ourselves from going in. But that man, when he got there, he said, that's not enough for me. I need you to pick me up and put me on top of that house. And God is saying the same thing to you. It's time you stand on top of that house. And it's time for you to demonstrate your faith. And they tore it up. They grabbed the tiles. And Jesus was there and he was looking up. And the tiles and everything was falling. And here comes, they lowered that man. And God looked at, and Jesus looked at him. And he demonstrated his faith that he told him, get up and go on your way. And he was healed. But you know the part about that? Yet there was people in that home that were there that missed out because they didn't demonstrate their faith. Hey, this is a time right now when you reach to him, when you tell him, you know, God, I'm going to demonstrate and I'm going to show you. You heard me say this before. It's time to break that family tradition of losing and start winning today. Because you are a winner. You were born that way. You have the royal priesthood bloodline flowing through you. So there's no reason why you should be laid up, broken, hurt, or even depressed. Because we don't serve a God that's like that. We serve a God who's strong, who's mighty, who's powerful. His blood is flowing through you. The anointing is inside of you. And the thing about it, when you hear the truth and you know when your heart is pounding and you're sitting there and say, he's speaking to me, that's when you say, yes, God, I receive it, I receive it. You're saying, is that scriptural? Write down Mark 2:5 and read it and come back and tell me. And I'll tell you that is true. That's an opinion. No, it's the truth. It's the word. Let's go. Let's stand. Let's praise. Not done yet.
Every word of worship,
with one accord.
this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe, we believe.
Be seated. Hallelujah. Oh, my goodness. God is good. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you. I thank you for being so obedient. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. Thank you. I'm going to step back before I get into the sermon. Do we have any visitors for the first time? Anybody new for the very first time? Anybody? Don't be shy. There we go. How are you? Thank you for coming. Let's get up, welcome, shake their hands. So good. Thank you for coming. Hallelujah. Before I get started in my sermon, that's me, I'm telling you. I'm real. Honey, can you? I found it. Okay, Father, help me find. He helped me find. Look at that. Thank you, God. He's so good. All right. Thank you. Well, I got an update. Before I get started, I want to give you an update. Dad is back in town. Rested. He received, was it a 30 years in the ministry from FCF. Isn't that great? 30 years in ministry at FCF. Fantastic. He and Reverend Eva, they're back. They're resting. Dad said he was swimming yesterday. He said they had a relay race against each other. He said that he lost, but he had a good time. He says he's still getting faster. I said, Dad, let it go. No, so Dad's happy. He's back. I talked to him yesterday. He's so excited. He said, be ready on Wednesday when he comes to preach. He said, because it's going to be really good. But you know, Dad, every Wednesday, every Sunday, when Daddy preaches, it's good. You know, and God, I tell you what, I was preaching on Wednesday, and, you know, I was talking about completion. Thank you. I was talking about, oh, there he is. Everybody, let's stand up. Let's give God praise, but stand up. Let's give my dad a clap. Amen. Yeah. Pastor's here, and Reverend Eva's here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, God is good. And you know, when I was preaching Wednesday, you know, I talked about completion. And I said that Dad, God birthed something inside of him. I said when he went to Bible school, you know, when we left. But the thing about it, when God gives you a dream, he's going to complete it. He will complete your incompletions. And what I was saying was when Dad has a vision, he had a goal and a dream of 500 or more. Did you hear it said 500 or more? And before, and Dad is never going to finish. What I'm saying is when he decides he wants to just go back and sit where he's sitting, there's going to be 500 or more sitting here, and we're going to add more. But did you hear what I said? But listen, you are part of it right now because you believe. But that's the thing about your dream in your life, and that's not even my sermon today, but that's the dream in your life. God is not done completing your dream yet. So don't think, oh, my gosh, it hasn't happened. There's a lot of things, and I preached on Wednesday. I encourage you to get the CD. Okay? I encourage you to get it. Also, July 27th, this is on a different note, we encourage you that day to come dressed, relaxed. So what we mean by that, we are having a family fun day. Wait, I'm going to say this even better. Free family fun day. Did you say free? Do we have to give something? No, just show up. Just show up. We're going to have hot dogs. We're going to have, you know, stuff for you to drink. We'll have water, good stuff. And then also, yes, because it's going to be hot, we're going to have inflatables for the kids. And then we're also going to have face painting for the kids. We also are going to have Family Olympics that day. The World Cup is happening, but we're going to have Family Olympics here at Agape. And you say, what is that talk? What are you talking about? And what I mean by that, you say, well, do I have to be in shape for it? No. If you can toss a sponge into a bucket, you're in shape. So that's what it's going to look like. And it's going to be fun. We're going to have horseshoes that day because I know we have some men that like to play horseshoes, correct? So we are going to have horseshoes that day all set up. There's some good things that are going to be happening. But on that day, it's going to be fun. That's why I talked to Dad. He said, that day, you don't have to wear a suit and tie. You can come relaxed. Bring a friend because that day is going to be awesome. We're going to have fun. And on that day, for the families, we're going to have gold, bronze, and silver medals to the winners. So look around you because the challenge is on between you. If you want to get in shape, start working that arm like you're writing with the pen. Okay? You're going to do some fun stuff that day. You say, is it going to be detrimental to my health? No, it's going to be detrimental to you laughing that much. That's what it's going to be. Okay? Does that make sense? And that's what it's all about. We're a family church. I'm really excited for, I think it's September. Don't quote me, but we are having our picnic. Who is on our picnic? Who's the people that are heading up our picnic this year? Please, come on, stand up. I know you're in here. There's one right there. Good. We are going to get that started real soon, and I'm so excited. Family God, where everybody's going to be there. I'm excited for the things we're going to do. And then also, update, we did get 3 bids on the children's wing. The next few weeks, they're going to paint it. It's going to be closed down from a Monday to a Friday. And all the colors, I'm pretty sad to see the bright green's going to be gone. So if you want to take pictures of what it used to look like, go in there. I encourage you to take a Snapchat photo or take a selfie yourself behind one of that bright paint, but it's going to be gone. And if you don't know what that is, bring your old Polaroid camera out and take a picture of it, okay? All right. Did I miss anything, honey? All right. Are you ready for the sermon?
Yes.
Praise God. Everybody say, I will be healed.
I will be healed.
Say, I will be healed.
I will be healed.
There you go. Hallelujah. I will be healed. Healing, we have to take it. That is what you need to do if you want to obtain your healing. Remember what I just said about the guy who was paralyzed? It wasn't enough that he just asked. It wasn't enough that he believed. He took his healing, right? And a lot of us, we need to take our healing. You know, we didn't have a problem in the world taking things when we needed it, right? Remember, I'll give this for you. You know when you went to the bar, when you went up for a drink and the bartender gave it to you, you took it, didn't you? You asked for it and you believed you were going to get it, but what did you do when it was right there? You took it, didn't you? The same thing with our healing. You're asking for it, you're believing for it, but you need to take your healing. In every area of life, obtaining victory boils down to one thing. You ready for this? You're going to say, are you going to give me something that's new? You know, what did I tell you before? You can never reinvent the wheel. You ready for this? Just take God at his word. If God says so, then it is so. But believing that what he says is the absolute truth and it will work if you only take a hold of it. See, but healing is no problem for the Lord. But the only part is getting people to believe what he said about it so you can receive your healing. See, but God has given each and every one of us a choice. And he said it this way. Ready for this? I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life, that both and thy seed may live. You know, I have all my daughters in here. You know, like with my daughter, we speak to her a lot about saying, asking, but also you have to do something also. And we tell her, honey, you need to demonstrate your faith. You need to demonstrate your walk. You know, and then I look at my niece right here. Oh, my niece is a very good dancer. My niece is very talented. But can you imagine if if Justine said, okay, Olivia, I'm going to take you to this dance place, and I just want you to go in there and dance. Well, we have to be taught, right? She has to be taught on how to dance. But I'm Olivia. I'm going to go in there and dance. Well, the same goes for us. We were been taught, and once we get the word and we apply the word, guess what happens after that? The healing will come in. But I'm going to get more to it. Like I said, this is great because I'm just learning on healing more and more. My dad, boy, he can teach. But let me get to the word. Deuteronomy 30, verse 19. You ready for this? We must choose to take what God has offered, and we must do it by force. Here's another scripture. Matthew 11, 12 says, if you need a healing, you just can't sit back and wait for God to drop it down on you. How many of us has waited and waited and waited and waited? You have to do what it takes so you can rise up in faith and take what rightfully belongs to you. See, but as Christians, here's the thing that we see that's more evident in a lot of people's lives. They walk around sick, full of fear, full of doubt, full of unbelief. How are you doing today? Well, you know, my leg is bothering me today, and God, this migraine headache right now. Ooh, girl, if you knew I've had this for a week. Really? Now, you know, I went to the doctor, but, you know, he didn't tell me anything, you know, that's going to help me. Okay. God has ever provided his healing power. And ready for this? He placed it on the inside of every born-again believer. But it's up to us to release it. Understanding and using the authority is the key to seeing miracles happen. But here's what the Bible shows about victories because of faith. Write down Hebrews 11, 1. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. But you know what now faith means? Ready for this? Now healing. Now restoration. Now life. Now miracle. It means now. Here's another scripture. Proverbs 4:20. My son, attend to my word. Incline thy ear unto my sayings. Let them not depart from thine eyes. Keep them in the midst of thine heart, for there are life unto those that find them, and health to all their flesh. Here's what the Bible says in John 10:10. The thief comes to kill, steal, and destroy. But my Father up in heaven says, I have come that they may have life and have it to the fullest. When he says full, he didn't say halfway. He didn't say quarter of a way. He says full, as in not needing any more. He says, in other words, it's complete. You are completely healed. See, but you will have life unto completion. Why? Because God wants you to understand that life and power are in the Word, is in the Word. See, but when God made the world, he created the earth, the sky, and the universe with his words. But see, don't you think that he can create a new heart for you? Don't you think he can create a new liver for you? Don't you think he can create a new lung for you? Well, some of you saying, well, I've lost a loved one. They passed away. Why didn't that happen for them? Let me keep going. His word is medicine and has a creative power because his words are spirit and they are life. But God's words is a never-failing remedy and not a remedy that has been passed down by family where you have to. You remember those remedies where you'd rub the lemon on your hand and you turn around 5 times? And then you'd have to lay on a certain side, and then your headache would go away. God doesn't work that way. Oh, come on. I know some of you know. You remember that. But God's word is a never-failing remedy for any situation or circumstance that may come at your life. You say, can God do it? You know, God is still not done healing. God is not finished yet. You know, I often hear of miracles where people receive a cloth. I know I've prayed for somebody, I think, 6 months ago, and I told you Wednesday that they came back and said they received their healing. Did it happen in a day? Did it happen in 2 months? I've heard where another person, within 2 years, same thing with prayer that here at Agape, that they ended up receiving and they were restored on the inside. But you know what? It was a process. They changed their eating habits. They changed the way they talked. They changed a lot of things, and they took it by force, but they gave God an opportunity to move inside and work with them. They didn't have a pity party and said, I'm going to feel sorry for myself. Can you imagine calling a friend and saying, oh, my goodness, I don't feel good today? No, they called a friend, and they said, well, hey, girl, how are you doing? Well, I feel great today. Really? Well, let me look at you. Yeah, you look great. But when you start to say things, you start to speak, you start to believe it, right, it's going to happen. The Bible says in Isaiah 54:17. Well, before I get to that. Too many people are leaving this earth at a young age when they don't need to. Let me get real for a second. You shouldn't at all. There's no reason why a kid or a young man or young lady, there's no way a parent should outlive his children. We as Christians have been given the right to live. Do you hear what I just said? We've been given the right to live. The Bible says in Isaiah 54:17, no weapon formed against us shall prosper. Cancer, Psalms 118, I shall not die but live. Leukemia, I shall not die, but live. Lymphoma, I shall not die, but live. Diabetes, I shall not die, but live. And shall declare the works and recount the illustrious acts of the Lord. When you use your scriptures and you look at Psalm 118, verse 7, I shall not die, but live. Deuteronomy 7, verse 15 says, the Lord will take away from you all the sickness. God has the last word and everything you need. But you know what? You are equipped. You are empowered. You are anointed. You are not at a disadvantage. You have the power of life to the fullest. And all the forces of darkness cannot stop you, cannot keep you from your destiny and from living. But the creator of the universe right now has just breathed his life into you. When you come to church, when you are at church at home, when you're listening to your CDs, when you're watching on TV, and man, you hook up with the anointing Did you know God is not a respecter of persons, that he can heal you right there? Did you know that God can move in that instant, in that moment, and take care of it? But you know God is not done with miracles. You look what he did for Moses. Here Moses with his faith, and when he just got staff and he went like this, how the Red Sea parted. You look with Daniel when he was in the lion's den, how he needed God, and God showed up. And I mean, it just gets better. You look Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. You look when Abednego, you see when they were in there. Oh my gosh, the fire. There was no way that they should have came out of that alive. But look at God when he showed up. Nothing was burned. Their hair, everything was great. And the king had to bow down to who? God, to Jesus, our Savior. Why? Because he's not done yet. And you may be in the fire right now. You may be in the midst of it. But I'm here to tell you that you will come out healed. You will come out on top. You will come out restored. But God is not finished with you yet. You need to declare in the name of Jesus, I am healed. I declare that I will live. I declare I will not die. The same God yesterday, today, he lives in you. You know what the evidence is? Is God is faithful in his word, and he hears your prayers. You are in covenant with the Almighty God. And you know what? The thing about it, when you understand the covenant, man, you have so much authority that Satan cannot even come at you. But when he does come at you, you have the word to battle back with it. You are so empowered. Let me give you some more evidence. Psalms 30, verse 2. I cried out to you, and you healed me. You may be dealing with sickness, but it's time to stand boldly and use your faith. Now is the time. Now is not the time to mope. It's time to let that go. The Bible says in Jeremiah 17, verse 14. I'm using a lot of words today. Kind of surprised, right? Heal me, O Lord. I shall be healed. Save me, and I shall be saved. You are my praise. The second you say, Lord, I receive you into my life, you just asked him in. At that very instant, you are saved. Lord, I thank you that I am healed. That very instant, if you hook up, and when you hook up, you will be healed at that very moment. There's a lot that goes to it, but look at your faith, your faith, your faith. When the going gets tough, the tough gets going. But get over disappointment and get over the self-pity and the self-doubt. Did you know you are armed with strength for this battle? What are you armed with? You're armed with your scriptures for the time right now. Oh, right now. I always call it my fundamental scripture. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. But it's one scripture. But it's the Lord's word. Remember what I told you? I pray for my daughter, my wife, the prayer warrior. When I always tell you, you cast your angels out, you send your angels out, you unloose and locking them, and they're behind your daughter. And for some reason, you're on your wife and says, I got a story to tell you, honey. I was on my way to work, and a car was coming at me, but it went another way. It looked like it was going to hit me, and it went another way. That was your angels just moving in and sliding it to the side. You call your angels to the hospital, and it's going to slide that cancer out of you. But you got to do something. Listen, I may call somebody up. My dad, I tell you, woo, he's taught me. He's still teaching me. You know, came out every day, Dad, man, I something's attacking me. And yes, son, thank you for calling me. And thank you for, you know, asking me to pray for you. But, son, you need to do it on your own. You're a grown man now. And you know the word. You've been taught. Yeah. You're right. Yeah. I do know the word. But see, that's with us. It is so great when we can hear it again and again and the repetition that we get it in our spirit. You know, like this, when you go to a restaurant, you know, you don't even need to look at the menu. You already know what it's going to get. I want the number 5. I want it medium well. And I'll take some Worcester sauce to the side. You read your scripture, you already know it. You're going to speak it. You're going to call it into existence. I want my healing. I want it today. I want it now in the name of Jesus. God, I thank you. I'm going to open my word up. This is my food. This is my manna. This, my Father, this is what you're doing for me. I said it the other day. The world does not have a problem taken from you. But it's time as Christians we take back from what the devil. We need to take it back. Yes. Come on, Holy God. Nothing can snatch you out of God's hand. The enemy doesn't have the final say. God has the final say. And he says the number of your days he will fulfill. So keep turning the page, believing and being your best, and he will move forward in another chapter in your life. See, some of you, you're stuck on chapter 4. And you know what? We're going to get out of that. Today is the day you're going to move into a new chapter in your life, a new beginning, a new time frame, a new day, a new beginning. Oh, my goodness. Your relatives are going to say, what happened to you? I went to church today, and God told me I am alive. And God told me I'm going to be here for your graduation. God told me I'm going to walk with your kids. God told me I'm still going to be here, and I believe what the word says.
Yes.
It's time to make that change on the inside so people can see it on the outside. But when you have God on the inside, he has no what? He is going to move on your outside. People are going to look at your expression and say, what happened to you? You're smiling more. Oh, yes, I am. Man, you're loving more. Yes, I am. And you know what? You're going to start to make some breakfast, lunch, and dinner for your husband or vice versa. Man, you're even going to maybe go vacuum your car because you're finally, you know what, this new chapter. God, I thank you. I thank you. But see, when you change, it's like when you read a chapter in a book, it's always something different, right? Well, look at your chapter of life. Chapter 3 might have been depression, doubt, but chapter 4 is going to say healing and restoration. Woo! Chapter 5 is going to say a new beginning. Oh, my goodness. In chapter 8 is going to see what? Financial. It's going to say so many things. Chapter 9. But it's up to you. It's up to you. It's always been up to you. My chapter in my life is continually to grow. Why? Because I'm including God in it each and every day. And man, every day I turn a page, God just, man, it's just great. Let me move on, okay? Let me talk about Job. Job. Oh, my goodness. You remember Job, right? Job was a great man, a very good man. Man, he was rich. He had everything. Oh, and he wasn't doing anything wrong. And that sound like us sometimes. We're not doing anything wrong. And all of a sudden, it seems like the bottom of the barrel has dropped out. Yet his life was turned upside down. Matthew 5, verse 45 says, the rain falls on the unjust. Here's about Job. Job was holy, yet he suffered. But just as God brought Job out of his affliction, so will he bring us out. We will go through the fire. I said that earlier. Look, here's Satan. Satan, man, he will disrupt. He will do anything to keep you from moving forward. He will throw trouble at you. He'll throw hardship at you. He will throw pain. He'll throw everything possible at you. And here's the thing about the storms of life. I'm going to get back to Job. The storm. You notice when you see a storm right away, you look outside, it gets dark. It gets gloomy. And what's the first thing you want to do? You want to take cover because you know what's coming, right? Honey, get in the house. Put everything away. Make sure nothing flies away because the storm's coming. The storms of life come to every person. You may get a bad medical report. In tough times, you may say, God, where are you? God, why is this happening to me? How could you let this happen to me? But I'm going to say this to you. But the same God who is in control in the good times, ready for this? Is just as in control in the bad times. He never said he would prevent every difficulty, but God, ready for this, did promise he would use every difficulty. What do you mean? God will direct the winds of the storm to blow you where he wants you to go. We see storms as negative. I can't believe this is happening to me. Ready for this? But God uses a storm to move you. And the winds may be strong, and the circumstances may look bad, but if you stay in faith and not waver and not complain, those winds will blow you to a new level of your destiny. It may be meant for harm, for God knows how to shift the winds. And he's still shifting the winds. Instead of blowing you backwards, he can use the wind to blow you forward, where you will come out stronger. And that storm will move to a place of a greater blessing. Shall I say, move you to a place of a greater blessing? But here's the main thing that I'm stating right here. If you have a house built upon the rock, If you have got unshakable confidence in God, if you know the Lord as your shepherd, then storms will come, but you will not be defeated. You will still come out a winner. You will still come out on top. You may go through the fire. You may go through the flood. You may go through the famine, but you will come out standing strong, and don't be discouraged by the storm. A few years ago, I went through a storm. Oh, man, I went through it with my body. I told my wife, I'll never forget, we're in Ohio, and there I was, and I got challenged. I got challenged, and there I was in the room, tears in my eyes. I said, honey, what did I do? What did I do wrong? I said, I do everything I can. Why? And when I got the revelation of it, and I read it, it totally blew me away. Do you ever consider that maybe it's because you're doing something right? You are setting a new standard for your family. And you ready for this? The enemy didn't roll out the red carpet and say, Joe, go ahead and finish your journey. He's saying to you, oh, I'm not going to roll it out and watch you finish your journey. Satan didn't want me to fulfill my destiny. And he threw everything he could at me. But I'm here to tell you, he didn't take me out, and he's not going to take you out. But know this, the forces for you are greater than the forces against you. I could have given up. I could have blamed God and thought, look at that. I'm sick. It's all over. I'm finished. But right in the middle, instead of quitting, I said, oh, man. Instead of giving up, I said, God, and I looked at the scripture, though he slay me. Here's what it says, though he slay me, yet I will trust him. When he was really saying, this is Job, I'm sorry. Let me get back to this. I'm going to get off track because I'm very good at that. You know me already. I'll get back to me. I could have stopped, but I just remember sitting in my dad's living room and I said, talking to him and telling him, and it was something new, but he said, son, he said, don't you know that we'll fight it and we'll beat it? And he said that to me, it clicked in. I said, Joe, what is wrong with you? You're such a coach, and you tell that we can never lose and we'll always win, and I teach them all the time plays and what we can do, that we don't back down from anybody. And just because a little thing moved in my body that it was going to break me, that's when I stood up and said, wait a minute. I know who's inside of me, and I need to stop it right there and don't let it take root. Because if I let it take root, I'm going to water it with my words, and it's going to become bigger and bigger. And then what's going to happen? I'm going to end up quitting. We don't quit. We don't stop. Going back to Job, right in the middle of the trials, he could have quit. He could have given up, become bitter. But he looked up at the heavens and said, though he slay me, yet I will trust him. What he was really saying, whatever comes my way, I'm not going to get bitter, angry, or upset. My situation may not be fair. Maybe you feel like Job today. You've been dealt an unfair hand, and you're saying what he said. But here's what Job said. I know a secret. My God is still on the throne. He will make my wrongs right. I may not like it, but I'm not going to get over it, and I'm going to continue to keep moving forward. Look at God. When you are faithful and your faith does not waver, he will show up on your behalf and make sure everyone knows who's in charge. You look at Job. If you read the story, 9 months later, he came out with double. Double everything. But see, there's tests, there's trials and tribulations that we may go through. And sometimes I'm telling you, they're not fun. Along that way, I've seen people, you know, where the devil has hit them with cancer. They've hit with the disease, and it hurt, and you watch them. It looks like they're deteriorating. It looks like they're ready to go home. But they stood on the word. They prayed. Like I said, there's asking and believing, but they did something about it. And along that way, at that moment, right when everybody was ready to give up, they were still pursuing God, and they were pursuing their healing. And here's what happens. They end up being restored. Their skin starts to change. Their eyes start to be vibrant. It's almost like when Jesus, when he was resurrected, you know, you look at him. We didn't get to see him, but can you imagine Jesus being resurrected? Can you imagine seeing him rise? What a sight that would be. But look on the inside of you. You're rising up with Jesus already on the inside of you. And that's the part about healing. When you get a hold of it and you get the revelation of it and you get the understanding of it, it can move in every area in your life. Oh, it can take control of you. And it's like a whirlwind, but that whirlwind's just going to push you forward. The choice is yours today.
Yes, it is.
You can either do it your way or God's way. You can choose the easy button, which is still going to stay at Staples, or you can choose the unshakable, uncompromising word of God and see Him work on your behalf. Call your angels. Oh, they want to work overtime for you. A lot of you have some big, tall angels, and they're ready to work. And you know, right now, it's evident in your life, they are working. Because some of the praise reports I've been hearing from you, oh my goodness, they're continuing to come in. Because in these last days, God is pouring out His Spirit, and He's showing more and more who He is. Oh, Satan's on a rampage right now because he knows he's already lost the fight. He knows he lost the battle. But he wants to drag you and say, you know what? When you go to church, that church stuff isn't going to work. I'm here to tell you, yes, God is not a church thing. God is God. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's a God who's more than enough. Hallelujah. Wow, I'm done. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. I thank you. I thank you for listening. I thank you for being obedient. I thank you for opening up your hearts. But I thank you in the Spirit how the anointing is, like I said, it's moving. God, I really like preaching. I like getting the word out. You know, I always tell you I'm learning. I love it. And I'm glad I get this opportunity. But payday for me or for my father is to see you make it. We're not going to struggle. We're not a family that struggles. And you hear I said we're not a family that struggles. We're strong. We need to continue to keep looking up. Because, you know, we're not like that, you know, like that rooster who's always pecking down, trying to find the next piece of food. We're like that eagle who rises and flies above, because that's what we are. And we got to continue to stay that way. The second you see yourself, or you start to say, you know, it's a tough day for me, that's when you need to dig in and look at your scriptures and look at the scriptures you wrote down, or pull out a Bible school DVD or CD and put it in and listen to faith, or listen to, you know, that day when you got your word, put it on. Let God's word be evident in your life, and let it just get inside your spirit again. And once you get that, you start to say, yes, God, you are right. I remember on that day, March 25th, 2013, when you said, I am healed. When you said, my life is going to be restored. Like Job, your day, your double's coming. Your double is coming. It is coming. It may have been taken away back in 2004. It may have been 1998, but I'm here to tell you, man, that miracle's coming, which you've been believing for. And then you're going to end up giving a praise report and say, Pastor, it happened. It happened. Why? Because you didn't quit. You didn't stop. You didn't give up on the word. It's right there. Remember what I said about your new chapter? Start your chapter. Start your chapter and write in it. Today's a good day to start it again. So maybe some of you, your chapter, man, you're on like chapter 2000 because your life is great. Then continue. Go to 2001 and write something new in it. Does that sound good? Hallelujah. Sherman? Thanks.
Hallelujah. It's time for tithes and offerings. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Tithes and offerings.